Hello, you're watching CSO Executive Sessions. I'm your host, Anne, and today I'll be speaking to Elina Noor, Senior Fellow in the Asia Program at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Thanks for making time to join me on the show, Elina.
Thanks for having me, Anne.
So in your area of research, you look into the impact of technology on governance and nation building in Southeast Asia. I think in the past, we didn't see much of a link between geopolitical risks and cyber threats. And to oversimplify this, one was often viewed in the context of foreign policy or military operations, perhaps warfare if things escalated, while cyber threats we generally associated with the private sector and attacks were often financially motivated. But now we're seeing an increasing convergence of the two. And perhaps you can shed some light on this. So we're here today to talk about geopolitical tensions in the South China Sea, which have existed for far longer than many of us realize, but we won't have time to get into all of it. So can you tell us what's driving it now? And what are the ensuing potential cyber threats as a result?
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up. As you pointed out, very often in the past, we used to silo economic and political considerations, and the cyber buckets were treated within those silos. But as many cybersecurity reports over the past 5-10 years have pointed out, the threat landscape is beginning to be more sophisticated. It's becoming more complex. We've seen that closer to home in Southeast Asia, in the South China Sea context, which is still underreported, but the cybersecurity reports in that space have pointed to an evolution of the threat landscape from what was primarily an interest in energy offshore deposits, so mainly for economic commercial reasons, in the late 2000s, 2009 or so. That's when a lot of companies, cybersecurity companies, were beginning to see interest in energy companies, for example, that were located or had interest in the South China Sea. And then over the years, as geopolitical tensions heated up over disputes over maritime rights, overlapping claims in the South China Sea, those cyber campaigns began to develop into more geopolitically focused attacks. And so you saw more advanced persistent threats targeting government agencies, but also the regional organization, ASEAN, in addition to private companies that were involved in helping mitigate or arbitrate this dispute at the international level. And so over the course of time, from 2009 onwards till about the peak of those geopolitical tensions in the South China Sea, 2013 to around 2016, when, if you remember, the Philippines took China to the Permanent Court of Arbitration, that was around 2015, when the results were announced, I believe it was, that highlighted the peak of that cyber campaign. And so if you look at what was going on at sea, the militarization of the seascape, the buildup, the artificial islands, they paralleled the cyber campaign that was taking place at that time as well. It's very difficult to obviously draw causal connections between the two, but when you place the timelines of what was happening in the physical space next to what was happening in cyberspace, you draw some very interesting comparisons.
And given that we are quite reliant on amity and order in the South China Sea for us to, for example, send and receive essential supplies and goods, to travel, for data connectivity thanks to undersea cables, and taking into consideration all this critical infrastructure, and also the increased connectivity within the maritime industry, you know, smart ports and recent Starlink deployment across entire fleets of some of the world's largest shipping companies. Should there be increased collaboration between the public and private sectors? And what are your recommendations for a more strategic approach?
Absolutely. I mean, as you pointed out, and as we just discussed, because the threat landscape is getting to be more complex, more textured, there needs to be greater exchanges between the public and private sectors. That exists now, but for example, in Malaysia, I'm not sure if this is still carried out every year, but the Malaysian government, in cooperation with a number of critical infrastructure sectors, banking, energy, health, telecommunications, so on, used to have an annual cyber exercise simulating attacks on any one of these critical infrastructure sectors. It's called Operation X Maya, and this used to be done every year for a number of years. It might still be going on now. And I think that's a really good example of how both the public and private sectors can exercise together in the event of a massive cyber attack happening. We've seen, for example, ransomware examples like WannaCry, like Petya, like NotPetya, bringing down whole industries. And it's at that point that everybody starts wondering, well, who bears accountability? Who's responsible for getting the system up and running? You mentioned submarine cables, and you know, there's a discussion right now at the international level as to whether to treat submarine cables as critical infrastructure or not. Many countries do not yet consider cables to be critical infrastructure, but they carry 99% of the data flows around the world for us. And as we're seeing right now with what's going on in the Red Sea, where cables have been cut in the context of a conflict, There are these questions about who's responsible for bringing up these cables for repair or sending down divers for repair and getting the internet flows running again. We just saw today, as of the time of recording, there were several cables that were damaged off of the coast of Africa. And so in the case of a conflict, as it is, you know, it's really difficult to ascertain what is happening when something is going on. It's even more difficult to send in repair ships, for example, to repair those cables physically. But remember, those cables are also connected to shoreline cables, and it's at the landing stations that cyber attacks can also happen. And so you have both the physical damage as well as the risk of cyber campaigns happening that could be very damaging for a whole economy.
Yeah. I'm glad you brought up NotPetya because so that was one of the most devastating cyber attacks that started off as a nation state attack against Ukraine. But, you know, that soon crippled privately owned corporations all the way in Australia as it blazed its way through the world. So perfect example of why the private sector should be on their toes if they observe mounting geopolitical risks. Do you think there's a likelihood of a cyber attack that could escalate to NotPetya proportions in our region?
There's always a likelihood. I mean, WannaCry hit our countries. You remember Stuxnet also made its way to a number of countries in the region. Indonesia was one of those hit. And so if we're talking about ransomware like NotPetya, proportions of which were massive, right? I think several companies like Maersk suffered millions totaling well into the hundreds. All it takes really is just one flaw, and usually that's a human flaw, for something of NotPetya to make its way like wildfire. And so if you're asking me, is there a possibility? There's always a possibility. And that's why, as you also pointed out, the private sector should be on its toes in observing what's going on in the larger geopolitical context.
And following the NotPetya attacks, I think when blowback, insurers were quite quick to cite war exclusion clauses when companies like Merck and Mondelez suffered losses. What are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, it's an interesting debate because there is a really robust discussion at the international level on whether cyber attacks can amount to a war-like scenario. This has legal implications, which obviously also has ramifications in the insurance industry. You know, whether a cyber attack can amount to war or not, it has been argued by some legal scholars, depends on the size of the attack, the magnitude of destruction or damage, and the scale of that destruction or damage. If, for example, an attack brings down a stock market or the bourse of a particular country, you know, that might cause massive panic. It might cause significant economic disruption. But whether it actually amounts to war in the physical sense is something that is left for discussion right now. And so the fact that insurers, I think, are taking their cues from some of these uncertainties in the legal space says a lot about the gray nature of just how much cyber attacks can make an impact in so many different industries. I think it provides a lot of uncertainty for businesses in how they operate, what kinds of risks they're willing to bear. But I think on the insurance side as well, they need to figure out their own risk appetite as well. And so there needs to be some sort of agreement reached on what it is, whether it's possible to quantify a certain amount of disruption that is so devastating that would amount to what we would consider war in the traditional sense.
Right. What do you think can be done to speed up the clarification of what's fair compensation, or how much shared responsibility there should be between insurers and the companies that are affected?
Yeah, that's a really difficult conversation, I think, because if we're talking about businesses having these conversations with insurers, that cost, I think, will inevitably fall to the consumer at some point in time as well. Part of the equation, right? You know, a huge company like Merck or Mondelez, they probably have a higher risk appetite. And if something like a NotPetya hits them and costs them a few hundred million dollars, they're a huge global MNC. But if NotPetya were to affect a much smaller company, 90%+ of businesses in Southeast Asia are SMEs, you know, and to take on the added burden of insurance is going to be an additional cost that most SMEs would probably not be willing to bear. And so I think part of the consideration has to be the size of the company, obviously, but also the breadth of its engagement abroad. So that will make a difference between your Merck or your Maersk and, you know, your regular SME that's just trying to make it in the world.
Yeah, that's a great point. And lastly, what are some blind spots we should all watch out for? And can you share some final recommendations for cybersecurity leaders in this region?
Yeah, I think it's basically what we've been talking about. We're no longer afforded this luxury of segmenting between what's purely commercial or economic and what is purely political. The lines are becoming more and more blurred. And this is evident in, for example, the major powers using economic tools as kind of weapons to get at each other. I use weapons in quotation marks. But I think it underscores the point that we have to consider business activities in a larger scheme of geopolitical dynamics and be more observant of really what world leaders are saying, because it does have economic repercussions, and those impacts are going to be passed on to your regular person who's just trying to, you know, buy a piece of product on an e-commerce site, for example. So the ripple effect is large and wide.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Elina. It was so great speaking with you today. Really appreciate you making time to share your thoughts with us. And to our viewers, if you have any suggestions or feedback on the show, questions you'd like me to ask our guests, feel free to reach out to me on LinkedIn. Thanks for watching.